नमस्कार, सत श्री अकाल, आदाब दोस्तों, स्वागत है आप सभी का एक बार फिर से कहानियों की हमारी इस खास मुहिम में, जहां हर खासो आम सुनाता है अपने जीवन के प्रेरक किस्से, प्रेरक अनुभव, और उन अनुभवों से हमें मिलती है एक नई सीख, एक नया जज्बा और नया जुनून। तो दोस्तों, कहानियों के इसी सिलसिले को आगे बढ़ाते हुए आइए बढ़ते हैं आज की अगली कहानी की ओर। ये कहानी है एल्सा मेरी डी सिल्वा के जीवन के प्रेरक अनुभवों के बारे में। दोस्तों, आपको बता दें, ये एक ऐसी महिला है जो कई लोगों की आवाज बनी है। जी हाँ, समाज के वो लोग जो अपने साथ हुई हिंसा के खिलाफ लड़ना चाहते हैं, उन पीड़ित लोगों के हक में इन्होंने अपनी आवाज बुलंद की है। ये रेड डॉट फाउंडेशन की संस्थापक और मुख्य कार्यकारी अधिकारी है। रेड डॉट फाउंडेशन इंडिया एंड यूएस बेस्ड एक ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है जो महिलाओं के खिलाफ हिंसा को समाप्त करने के लिए काम करता है। ये रेड डॉट फाउंडेशन द्वारा विकसित एक ऑनलाइन प्लेटफॉर्म सेफ सिटी की इनोवेटर भी है, जिसे इन्होंने 2012 में लॉन्च किया था। इसके अंतर्गत सार्वजनिक स्थानों पर यौन हिंसा और उत्पीड़न की रिपोर्ट को ट्रैक करने के लिए क्राउडसोर्सिंग का उपयोग किया जाता है, और शहरों में असुरक्षित क्षेत्रों को दिखाने के लिए इस डेटा को मैप किया जाता है। दोस्तों, आपको बता दें, डी सिल्वा द्वारा किए गए सराहनीय कार्यों के लिए इन्हें अब तक कई अवार्ड से सम्मानित किया जा चुका है, जिनमें डिजिटल विमेन इन सोशल इम्पैक्ट अवार्ड, फीमेल एंटरप्रेन्योर ऑफ द ईयर अवार्ड, भारत सरकार का 2016 विमेन ट्रांसफॉर्मिंग इंडिया अवार्ड सहित अन्य कई अवार्ड शामिल है। इन्होंने जिस तरह यौन और लिंग आधारित हिंसा के खिलाफ आवाज उठाई है, महिलाओं और अन्य वंचित समुदाय को अपनी चुप्पी तोड़ने में जिस तरह इन्होंने मदद की है, इसके बारे में महिलाओं को जागरूक करने का काम किया है, ये वाकई में सराहनीय है। दोस्तों, निश्चित ही इनकी इस नेक सोच, विचारों और इनके अनुभवों से आज कई लोग प्रेरित होंगे, ऐसा हमारा विश्वास है। तो आइए दोस्तों, अब वक्त हो चला है इनसे सीधी सीधी मुलाकात करने का। तो मिलते हैं हमारी आज की खास मेहमान एल्सा मेरी डी सिल्वा से, और सुनते हैं इनके जीवन के प्रेरक अनुभव, इनकी ये प्रेरणादायक कहानी सिर्फ और सिर्फ इनकी अपनी जुबानी।
हेलो, माय नेम इज एल्सा मेरी डी सिल्वा एंड आई एम द फाउंडर ऑफ रेड डॉट फाउंडेशन। वी आर अ नॉन प्रॉफिट बेस्ड इन इंडिया एंड इन द यूएस। वी वर्क ऑन जेंडर इक्वालिटी and in particular, prevention of sexual and gender-based violence. Our flagship program is Safe City, which is a crowd map where we encourage anonymous reporting of sexual and gender-based violence incidents. And these stories are then plotted on a map and visualized as location-based trends. And we use that data to engage individuals, institutions, and communities on safer spaces in their cities and college campuses. I was born in Bombay and literally lived all my life in this city. And I had a very privileged childhood, I guess. So I come from a middle-class family, but you know, didn't really have to suffer the stereotypical patriarchal culture in my family. All of us were treated equally. I was allowed to follow my dreams, pick my career option, decide whether I wanted to marry or not, and there was no family pressure. At a very early age, when I was 19, I joined Jet Airways as a flight attendant, and over a 20-year period, I worked across two of India's largest airlines, Jet Airways and Kingfisher Airlines, first as a flight attendant, then a safety instructor where I was teaching pilots and cabin crew safety and emergency procedures. And subsequently, I was selected for a fast-track career progression, which took me into the strategic side of the business. So first, revenue management in Jet Airways. And then later, when Kingfisher started, I was headhunted to head pricing and network planning. And my last portfolio was vice president network planning, where I had to manage 500 daily flights. So what influenced me? So, you know, several things. So from an early age, I was pretty independent. I was traveling the world both for work and for leisure. And I realized that not many other women had these experiences. Many were not allowed to travel on their own. They had family pressures. Also, they didn't have financial independence. And so that bothered me. I wanted this life that I was used to and experienced to, you know, extend to everybody I knew, because travel is an education in itself. And so I decided that one day I would work on empowerment of women so that they didn't have to depend on other family members. But of course, what exactly I wanted to work on was not very clear to me. It was just that I am very passionate about women having equal rights. And also, since I was a safety instructor, I kind of, you know, was entrenched into this building situational awareness, which later on I realize I use a lot in my work in Safe City, and I'll explain how. So coming to the career switch, in 2012, many things happened. One was I was reaching my saturation point in the corporate sector. I was looking for my purpose, wondering what I was going to do next. I'd already reached, you know, from a flight attendant to a vice president, and I was also bored and I wanted to do more with my time. And so, like I said, you know, for many years I'd been thinking about women's rights but didn't know how to contribute in that segment, until December 2012, when Jyoti Singh, who we call Nirbhaya, was gang raped on a bus in Delhi and then left to die on the streets. That incident opened up, if, as you may recall, the conversation around sexual and gender-based violence in the country. And I was reminded of my own experiences of being harassed on a bus, on the public transportation, in the streets, and also at the workplace. And I realized that many of us, including my friends who were now sharing their stories, many of us had never made a formal complaint, either at the police station or with our employers. And many of us never even spoke to each other about it. And I realized there was a data gap that exists and which needed to be bridged. And that's why Safe City came into being, to document and make it more visible. And then subsequently, what do you use that data for? And that data really helps to build your situational awareness. If I am going to a new city, or if I'm going to a different part of my city, or even if I'm a resident of a suburb, how much information do I have about safety? And do I get that information easily? In India, if you want crime information, you would have to make a right to information application at every single police station. And the National Crime Research Bureau statistics do not give you granular information at your street level. That's why this crowdsourced data set is so valuable and important, because it tells you what's happening where you are, or you can zoom in right up to the street level. And the next thing is, okay, how can I use that data? So it's not about being afraid and avoiding the space, but really, if I knew that this was going to happen, how can I change that? How can I work with my authorities? How can I pressurize them to release more money for budgets on, you know, measures that really work? How can I strengthen policies? How can I work with my community? Because we are all part of communities. Is it okay to harass a woman? Is it okay to abuse somebody? And if it's not, then they have a role to play in creating that safe ecosystem. And with this data, you can actually engage them in dialogue and helping them see the problem and then getting them to, you know, fix the gaps. So that's how I approached my work. I draw a lot from my previous work in my current work. And yeah, it's, you know, it's been very satisfying the last 10 years. And in the meantime, of course, Kingfisher Airlines did shut down, but then I had already made this switch to the development sector. So yeah, so I hope I've answered your question. You know, my journey is not linear. I never anticipated what I was going to do next. If you had asked me this question, and I really hate this question. What are you going to do 5 years from now? I can't tell you, because I could never have told you 10 years earlier, 15 years earlier. Every 5 years, I literally changed paths. Even if I worked in aviation and in two airlines, I did extremely very different roles. So I would say my journey has been absolutely interesting, fascinating, satisfying. I've done everything that I set out to do. I've worked really hard. I've been open and flexible, because most often I've been headhunted for these positions. Even within my airlines, I was always picked for the promotion. So, and that says something to women. You know, at that time, we weren't talking a lot about diversity and inclusion and gender. And as you know, women are socially conditioned to not take many risks in life. And had it not been for sponsors and mentors within my corporates, I may never have taken the, you know, decision on my own to change career paths very often. So having mentors along the way really helps. I didn't have role models, so I can't say I have role models, but I did have mentors. And I did ask a lot of questions. I was always curious. And when my bosses gave me work that was not in my job description, I took it on as a challenge and used it to upskill myself. Now, when it came to the social sector, again, I was starting from zero. I had to forget that I had a designation of vice president. In my organization, when you're starting off, it's literally you're the office boy or office girl, right up to the CEO and everything in between. So, you know, doing your finance, doing your marketing, doing your social media, designing your programs, delivering the trainings, doing the business development, maybe even updating the website was something that I had to do. So I did it because I had to do it. And I was passionate about the topic, so I wanted to do it. And that motivated me because I knew I was doing something really important and it was making a difference in the lives of women and girls. Also, how do you build a team? So you ask for help and you tell people what you're doing. And they say, you know, you're a leader if you have followers. And so you create that avenue for people to follow you. So I have a lot of volunteers and interns, and slowly people who I'd worked with and had taken a career break, especially mothers with young children, asked if they could be part of it. And they formed my team as well. So yeah, so I put together a team of diverse people, young people, women who'd taken a break, older people, and then one thing at a time, simple projects, testing hypothesis, doing micro projects, and doing pilots in different cities, and then documenting it, learning it from it, acknowledging that I didn't have all the answers. Over a period of time, it's your sincerity, integrity, and your passion that will sustain you and also get people to believe in you. When you are in the, I do believe that anything that you do, it's not a sprint, it's a marathon. So you have to pace yourself, and it's your life work that speaks for yourself. So for example, you can't come overnight and try to do good, right? You should have been doing good for the last 20 years, 25 years, even if you were not in the sector. People in the previous sector, in the corporate sector, also know what I did there, and they are willing to bet on me. So that's how it works, right? You can't just pop up on the scene and expect people to invest in you, believe in you, if you don't have a background. So that's why they say, treat people well on your way up, because on your way down, probably you will need their help. And I'm proud to say that I have a very vast network. I've given a lot and received a lot in return, but I do give very freely to a lot of people. So I believe that's also karma, right? What you give out, you receive back. Yeah. So a combination of a lot of things. So I had a donor who came to me in the US and said, I want to give you money and a very large sum of money for our mobile app. And at that time, we didn't have the required permissions from the government of India to receive foreign funds. And so I had to open a US nonprofit to receive the money because we tried many different ways and none of it was working out. So we opened up a US nonprofit. But in hindsight, it actually worked for us because we were able to support our work globally, which as an Indian nonprofit, I'm not allowed to do under government regulations. And thus far, it has been managed by volunteers. I met people along the way who I felt was passionate enough to join my team, like I said. So they are professors of sociology, criminology, my ex-colleagues from Kingfisher Airlines who'd resettled in the US, students that I had worked with. And yes, so we are running it. From January this year, I've taken on a more global role with the US nonprofit because my India nonprofit is being handled by my colleagues. So I am now building that organization and hopefully we will be able to show a lot of impact because we already have chapters in 12 countries and we are now going to support them in a more structured manner. I make mistakes every single day. And when you're starting something new, which has never been done and which you've never done, you're going to make mistakes. But I look at it as how do you handle that mistake? So it's not about the mistake, it's about how do you handle the mistake after it has been made. And for that, I would say your value system comes into play and your self-belief. So how do you treat the person if there are people involved? How do you handle the situation in the most sensitive manner in alignment with your values is what is key. I can't remember what mistakes we made because I've always learned from them. And mistakes are also, you've tried it, it didn't work, and you move on. So you now rule out that possibility because it doesn't work. Or maybe that was ahead of its time. Now, also with mistakes is, maybe you never thought about it. And therefore, you know, you had a failure. So the next time you correct that and you improve upon it, right? That's how I look at mistakes and failures. I don't dwell too much on it. I'll learn from it, see what best we can do the next time and move on. My success is that I've lived a life worth living. I don't regret any moment at all. I've always lived it on my own terms as per my value system. And I'm very proud that along the way, I've been able to, you know, be there for a lot of people. I've created spaces that are safe for people to share their vulnerabilities. I've created opportunities for people to thrive and achieve their potential. And I try my best to do that. I know I'm just one person and I have limited, you know, ability and reach. So whatever I can do, I try my best. And for me, that's what keeps me going, motivates me, and I'm very happy and proud of whatever I've created and designed and developed. And I'm very proud that I have lots of friends who, so not just friends, my family too, who support me unconditionally. And I think that's also a testament of a life well lived. It doesn't matter if you're in corporate or you're in the development sector or in the government. Always have a curiosity about life around you. You don't have the answers. No one is an expert because things are changing so quickly. You have to constantly update your knowledge, upgrade your skills. So adopt a mindset of agility, flexibility, open-mindedness, and the learning mindset. And then treat people with respect and be self-aware. Again, self-awareness is an exploration. Be comfortable with who you are. Play from your strengths and don't worry too much about what the world thinks about you. Know who you are, what you want out of life. You only live it once and do your best to live it well. I had a very small network. So I observed how hard they worked for most of their lives, how diligent they were. They had a value system. They were kind. They helped others. You know, and they treated everyone equally. So I would say that they are my role models, and I've taken the good paths from them and made it my own. I'm a workaholic, but I'm proud to say that my work, my passion and hobbies are pretty much the same. So there's a very blurred line. However, I'm very conscious that I need to exercise and do some mindfulness activities. So I do yoga. I host Surya Namaskar challenges for my friends because I need that motivation of group work. I try to exercise 3 times a day. I walk. I like walking in the park. It also helps me think. The work I do is purposeful, so it also gives me that sense of satisfaction. And I've started drawing from this year. I never thought of myself as an artist, but as a mindfulness activity, I've taken up drawing. I read a lot and I like just my downtime is with my closest friends and a glass of wine. Both are important, but I would give more weightage to experience. Be the change you wish to see. And the other one is don't beg, borrow or steal. It is good to have equality and that we must all strive to do our bit to ensure that everyone has a safe, equal, fair opportunity to live our lives.
दोस्तों आप सुन रहे थे एल्सा मेरी डिसिल्वा की प्रेरक कहानी इनकी अपनी जुबानी. ऐसी ही प्रेरक कहानियाँ रोजाना सुनने के लिए चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करें और बेल आइकन जरूर दबाएं. और अगर आज की ये कहानी आपको पसंद आई है तो इसे लाइक, कमेंट और शेयर जरूर करें. दोस्तों वर्क मॉब आपको दे रहा है एक सुनहरा मौका अपने विचारों को व्यक्त करने का, अपने अनुभवों को साझा करने का और अपने जीवन की कहानी देशवासियों तक पहुँचाने का. तो आइए और जुड़िए आप भी इस मुहिम में हमारे साथ और अपनी कहानी से दीजिए सभी को एक नई प्रेरणा. लेट्स इंस्पायर टुगेदर, वी कैन, इंडिया कैन. जी हाँ, आपकी कहानी में ताकत है लोगों का जीवन बदलने की. तो दोस्तों सुनाइए अपनी कहानी और ले आइए लोगों के जीवन में आशा की एक नई किरण. कीजिए सभी को इंस्पायर. फिलहाल वक्त हो चला है आप सभी से इजाजत लेने का, लेकिन बहुत जल्द एक बार फिर होंगे हाजिर एक नई कहानी के साथ. तब तक के लिए आप बने रहिए हमारे साथ, देखते रहिए कहानियों का हमारा एक खास कार्यक्रम और लीजिए हर नई कहानी से हर दिन एक नई और सच्ची प्रेरणा. नमस्कार.